Yesterday we had Craig's hut, today we got Fry's hut down on Hakwa Track, I think the name of it's called. The other side of Craig's hut. Fred Fry was a legend. He lived on this site for many years until his death in 71. They worked as carriers, driving drays and pack horses over the mountains. That would have been a harsh job. Still in the Victorian High Country. This is west of Mount Buller, so we didn't actually go into Mount Buller for this. The turnoff's about 10k before Mount Buller. This is down on the river. Fry's hut.
He was a bush carpenter.
There you go, bush carpenter.
Built several huts along the Hakwa River, most with drop slab walls, log rafters, providing large roomy huts.
Anyway, we'll take you for a walk through it, if the light allows us to film it. Sometimes it gets too dark and the GoPro can't actually pick it up. There's his hut from the outside. As you can see, it's cold and wet. It's been raining heavy overnight. Track in's fairly good. Four-wheel drive high all the way in. There are very blind corners with lots of corrugations on it, so you just drive to the conditions, but four-wheel drive high on the way in.
Yeah.
And this gives you Fry's hut.
And you give
me. We've got to navigate the pond. Let's see how we do this. Maybe around the other side, that's drip, drip, drippy. Would anyone be at home?
Me, just me.
Mr. Fry's house.
Pretty big.
Pretty big place for.
Well, this would be
his lounge dining room.
Dining room.
One of these would be bedrooms, possibly two of them are bedrooms. He's got his balcony out there, so I assume that's the front. This might be his woodworking area where he did his bush carpentry.
And then you've got this room here. One would have to be laundry, kitchen.
Bit of canvas hanging off the wall, the roof. One might be kitchen laundry, yeah.
He
didn't
park his car in the
garage or anything. No, he had horses. No, he wouldn't put the horses in here for shelter. This is his hut, which is substantially bigger than Craig's hut. Yeah. 1, 2, 3. Well, we're thinking they're bedrooms. 2 bedrooms. I'm not sure what this area would be. Might be kitchen laundry, this area. And maybe this might be a workshop that he used because he was a bush carpenter. So maybe it was a workshop for him. You can actually camp here as well. It's like a free camp, so you've got to have your own power and water and toilet. I'm not sure how you book it. Maybe you book it through the Victoria Vic Parks, they call it in Victoria, Vic Parks, which is like a national park in Victoria, but there's a campground. It's called Fry's Flat campground. And like I say, it's, you have to be self-sufficient, so you have your own water and power, toilets, etc. I'm not sure of the price of it, but yeah, Fry Flats Campground it's called. Just off Fry's Hut.
Seems to be easing up a bit, but onto Halcourt Track, then what comes down from up above the mountains, obviously, all runs down. Everything runs downhill, so in the lower parts it's going to have more rain.
That's Sheet Yard Flats. Tunnel Bend, Alpine National Park, Noonan's Flat.
I can't see that.
So if you go right where all the other cars just went, they'd go out to Devon's Flat, Pickering's Flat, Noonan's, Tunnel Bend, and Alpine National Park.
I wonder how hard that is. Could have just kept following.
We might take it on.
Do you think we can turn around?
We'll have a look.
We're going to have a little pokey along. We're thinking.
Can't be too bad. If the road stays the way it is, it shouldn't be too bad. When possible. I'll just turn this off because it's been programmed to take us somewhere else.
We made a really quick decision then, because there's other cars travelling just in front of us.
CB's been busy with people around, so there's going to be people around if we do get stuck.
Bit of safety in numbers.
CB's been going to pick people around, so there's always going to be someone there to help if you do get lost or not so much stuck, but not sure where to go.
Just taking us down to another little campsite.
Nice little river running along there.
Burnings or Pickering's Flat.
Catch it on this sign here. This one is Devon's Flat. Devon's Flat Campground, this one is.
Another free camp, as in you've got to have your own power and water.
Devon's Flat Campground still. We're following a little creek river along here. Oh, another campsite. They just pop up. Noonan's Flat Campground. Big water drop on it. That's the river. So these guys have just dropped off, they're going into the Bend campground and they're going to have a look in there. So we've got a fair bit of traffic coming along this way still. To have a look. We might be going to have a spot of lunch or something in there. Tunnel Bend. Walking tracks that take you down to the river. walking and horse riding track to the right there. We saw another group of riders down at Fry's Hut getting ready to go on a trail ride together. Parkour Hills Historic Area.
Alpine National Park.
Coming into the Alpine National Park now. Which national park roads are usually, they're pretty well maintained. They have a lot of traffic through them, so I try to stay on top of them. But with rain and whatnot, you never know what's around the next bend, really. Still hanging around. Slam through the trees. Those guys were fair motoring.
Just around the last left hand hairpin. Thanks, boys.
What's that?
Thanks, boys.
Were they P-platers?
The professional drivers with the P's on their cars.
Should be, but you do get your couple of nutters that have no fear.
One in every group.
I think they're invincible. Anyway.
Moving on.
So, this is Tunnel Bend Campground, Alpine National Park. And, yeah, we've found a nice flowing river, which is pretty awesome. Snowy River. Not the Snowy River, but Snowy Mountains National Park. Not sure what the river's name is. Gonna have some bottle lunch here and continue back up to a town called Gillygog. I think it's called Gillygog, Milligog. Probably get some fuel and we'll head into Circuit Road, do some see if we can go to the falls in Circuit Road. I'm not sure what the name of the falls is called, but we'll go into Gillygog, get some fuel after we have some lunch here and do a bit more exploring.
Lunchtime!
Yeah, so this, you can camp here, it's a free camp and it's Tunnel Bend Campground. It's got fire pits. Again, you've got to be self-sufficient, water and power, you've got to bring your own water and power along, you've got to take all your rubbish out. Yeah, very nice.
by a water to find a waterfall. Do you remember the name of the waterfall?
I can't for the life of me remember it. And it's not in the hammer, so.
Anyway.
Barrowba Falls? I don't know.
You can just wing it. It'll be signposted anyway. The signposting up here is really good.
The road up is really quite good. The first section coming out from the Mount Buller, Mount Stirling turnoff, the bitumen there, the first 4 or 5K up the hill, has been noticeably chopped out with ruts. We're thinking it's the rain overnight and also the traffic. But once you're up and you hit Telephone Booth Junction, get the information centre there, and you hit Circuit Road itself. It's four drive high, I've got 30 psi on all four tyres. Quite smooth, quite easy to drive. Quite comfortably doing 30-40 k's an hour, which you wouldn't want to be travelling any quicker. Some people are travelling a bit quicker, there's even motorbikes about, so you've got to have your wits about you. I got headlights on. I was running the spotlights on as well because we came through a fog. That's cleared. And we're now top in between Mount Stirling and on our way to the waterfall. So we'll find a waterfall hopefully for you guys to look at. We've just got to get to the junction, which is 7.5k away. And that's where the road divides, and I think we start getting signs for the waterfall. Rain's starting to stop. It's forecast to clear up, but it starts and stops and starts and stops, and you get heavy fog. So.
A lot of people have been saying it was going to rain and then possibly snow.
Yeah, I thought it ran wide and then caught up.
Ran into a really nice couple, funnily enough, from down near home. They from Warhope. They camped up next door to us, point to point.
Shout out to Point Adventures.
They've given us some really good advice and tips. Really nice couple. Well travelled. Pretty knowledgeable on what they're doing.
Back north tomorrow. Don't know. something you can't really explain, but once you get here, you do fall in love with it. It's changing. It changes hourly, the scenery and the conditions, and just the views you can get to. It's just awesome. It's something to, you know, really can't explain it without writing books about it. But it's a very special part of the world. I enjoy being down here very much, and really like driving through it, and exploring different parts of it. We haven't certainly covered any significant amount of it. Craig's Hut's probably the biggest trip we've done.
You've barely touched the surface.
Barely touched the surface of it. Like, you can pack up and go for a week and just travel through the Victorian High Country for three or four days, and you'd still only see half of it. So,
no, not even.
It's just part. It's just spectacular.
But there's also always more trips to be made down this way when we want to. That's the joy of having life on the road. We go where we want, when we want. Lucky enough to have our eldest daughter renting our house, so it's pretty safe and secure. She keeps us informed on the state of the place, and anything that goes wrong, she's straight on to letting us know so we can get repairs done. But we haven't really had too many of them, because she's not like anybody else who's just going to get in there and mistreat the place, because she knows it's our home. So she's doing a good job helping us out. We're helping her out.
Fuel pump that just confused the hell out of us.
That was a first.
You had to put in you had to guesstimate how much you're going to have to put in your car. And if you put, say, $100 down because you needed a full tank of fuel, you only use 80, you got $20 for the next bloke to come along and go, shit, I got free $20 free fuel. Woohoo! So, yeah, I don't know how exactly that works, but if you're good at maths, you could probably work it out at $2.15 a litre. You kind of double that, you kind of work out, well, if 15 litres is going to cost me $30, I put 20 litres in, that's going to cost me $60. So we went $40 and it gave us 25 and a half litres, which didn't quite fill it, but that's all right. We've got enough here to have fun with. Gets us through the park today and back to the van park tonight. And if need be, we can fuel up on the road tomorrow with the van on our way north. And we got sunshine now, guys. See, that's just how quickly the weather up here changes.
Blue sky.
That's how quickly the weather in the high country changes. You got sunshine 1 minute, and you can turn the next corner around and it's bucketing down rain with fog. And get to the next corner and it's clear. So it's just quite magical the way it changes the weather down here.
Sitting on 8 degrees at the moment.
A balmy 8 degrees.
2:30 in the afternoon. We don't really get cold though when we're having stays like this, because the car's got heating in it and we've got jumpers and long pants on and
beanies.
beanies and thick jackets for when we're out of the car, and when we're back at the van, we've got air conditioning, heating there, and we've got electric blanket on the bed. So, you know, happy days. Sometimes it's really nice to really enjoy the fresh, crisp, cool air anyway, you know? It's a complete different experience.
We do see people with tents up and their swags out, and I think, Jesus, how do they do it? They do it hard at night, because it gets down to, in some areas, it gets down to 3 or 4 degrees. And I know myself, I wouldn't be happy in a swag if it was 3 or 4 degrees out. And we've come to the right place, fellas. This is Bundary Falls.
5 kilometres.
Bundary Falls, that's the one that we've been trying to get out of our brain for you guys to know.
Bundary Falls. So we're just going to have a photo opportunity here, so just hang with us for a minute, guys. So it's 5Ks to Bundary Falls. Reloading the HEMA. That doesn't recognise Bundary Falls, but that's alright. I'd say it's going to be just on the western anyway.
Pretty straightforward. Seen up here. A lot of those Subaru Foresters getting around, they're all-wheel drive. Certainly not a four-wheel drive configuration. You can do it easily in two-wheel drives up here. As long as you've got decent all-terrain tyres on, we use Falcon Wild Peaks. Shout out to Falcon. Sponsorship issue if you want to get sponsored. We did run Toyo tyres before, open countries. We found they wore real quick, they were softer, so we only got 20,000 k out of them. We've got fucking Wild Peaks on now for 30,000 k's in that because they haven't even worn a bit. So they're just a bit more solid a tyre. But for us, they're just the right mix for what we need to get around in.
And speaking of people bringing their two-wheel drives up, it's you can still get to Craig's Hut in a two-wheel drive. It just means that you have to park in a parking bay, which is signposted, and you just walk up through the bush to the actual Craig's Hut. So you just don't, there's just one section where you need a four-wheel drive to get up there if you want to drive all the way up.
It's the last 2 k's in. Quite steep, quite rocky, a couple of really severe weird boys in there. But having said that, we drove up to the Craig's Hut car park, and it was a two-wheel drive car park unit.
I guess it depends what damage you want to do to your two-wheel drive when you can park it and walk a couple of K. You know? Each to their own, I guess, when you're out and travelling. David and I have invested too much time and money into the D-Max just to flog it about too much. What do you reckon?
Yeah, well, if you're sensible, you can. There's a few things, admittedly, that we've probably bought that may not get used on a trip, but once you do need to use it and you haven't got it, you're going to say, oh, I really need it, but... like, we found out the issue with tidal flares. We went out and bought highly recommended tidal flares at a discounted price, but at this stage can't figure out the way of running them because I'm going to rip the valve seat out of the tyre, so I'd rather just use a basic common tyre deflator.
Works just the same. Lets the air out and pumps the air in when you need it.
But each to their own, like some people like to travel with all the bells and whistles, and like I saw a sticker on a car saying all the toys and no all the
it's Kookaburra.
All the tools and no clues. So each to their own. You can travel as heavy or as light as you want. And you also got to consider what sort of travelling you'll be doing when you do travel. A lot of people just stick to the bitumen. They miss out on half the fun, like what we're doing, but everyone's travelling differently. Everyone's got a different way of seeing this country. Others prefer to stick on the dirt and not go to bitumen town or townships. Completely avoid people, but that's their choice as well.
We've learnt through the courses and research and stuff that we've done though that to be underweight when you're travelling with either your four-wheel drive or your four-wheel drive in combination, whether it be a camper trailer or caravan, off-road, road, doesn't matter, to be underweight is going to ensure that if anything does happen, and hopefully it never does, but it ensures that you're going to get your insurance. If you're overweight, you just forfeit your insurance straight up, regardless of what the damage is or how it happened. So, being underweight is always extremely advisable.
There's another fine example of someone hitting the road correctly. He was flat out on the wrong side of the road. Anyway.
Yeah, people, going back to the insurances, people don't realise a lot of times that even with your four-wheel drive alone, it alters the actual weight of your car. So if you have an accident and you're fully loaded and you're overweight, you're not going to be insured. So, it's imperative that it's checked, really, for your own benefit. We're due for another weigh-in. It's been a while. I kind of like to do it at least once a year. We're always buying stuff and putting it in the van, but in saying that, we're always taking stuff out of the van. So the weight usually always is changing for us. So I want to try and stay on top of it, just to ensure that if anything happens, we're covered.
When you do go ahead and weigh yourself, you've got to do it with a full tank of fuel, your car and the van's loaded.
So any water?
You're travelling at correct weight. A lot of people will just get the car with half a tank of fuel in it and have the caravan and the stuff they have in it and not weigh it and go, yeah.
It even goes to the point where you have to have the exact people in the car when you go to weigh the car that you're going to be travelling with. So, if David weighed our car without me in it, he's going to substantially lose a lot of kilos when I get in. I'm not a featherweight. Not huge, but it's every kilo adds up, doesn't it?
Yeah, it creeps up into your GBM, and when you got at maximum, you got to do a GBM upgrade, and they're not exactly cheap. But like before, we were saying with the insurances, if you're in an accident, the first thing they do is they weigh your car and they weigh your caravan. And I'll add the two together and look up your GVM weights on Google. And if you're even a kilo over, the insurance won't even come to the party. They'll just go, yep, you're overweight.
Yeah.
Bad luck.
And we found the easiest way for us to weigh in is to pack up. Like we're about to hit the road, or now we're living on the road, we're constantly loaded up like that anyway. We just got to make sure the water tank's full in our car and in the van. And a fuel tank of fuel, And even our food, we've got to make sure that we've got all the food that we can got that we're going to fill the cupboards with. So the easiest way for us now is we just go to a tip, don't we?
Yeah, just go to a weighbridge and tip.
Go into a weigh, yeah.
They might charge you $10, but then you can get an accurate weight of what's going on, and they're quite happy to do it for you.
Well, with your $10, you also get a printout, so you can put your printout in your with your logbook, and you know.
Here's our weights.
You've got that security and peace of mind. Well, that's what we do anyway. You know? Like David keeps saying, each to their own, and everyone does things a different way. If anybody's got anything that they'd like to add to it, feel free to throw something into the comments. The more interaction we get with people, the more we learn.
Hit that subscribe button, smash that follow button. I'd like to show you around the country.
This 5K seems to be a long 5K.
There's a lot of hairpins in this, and they're not exactly shallow hairpins either, they're quite tight.
Pindary Falls.
No, I couldn't spell it right, that's why it wouldn't show up. With the hammer, you've got to have your spelling exactly right, otherwise the machine will say unrecognised. You won't be able to get to the destination you want to get to, so you've got to make sure your spelling's absolutely on track. Otherwise, your hammer won't even pick it up. Let's go and check the falls out.
Pindary Falls.
Hi.
Pindary Falls. We just walked 400 metres near vertically to get here from the car park. We're a bit knocked up, but yeah, Pindary Falls.
Definitely got to get some kilos on.
Yep. Mountain goats going on. I'm happy just looking at it from here. Yeah. Challenging walking straight up. Well, quite steep in. And because it's wet, it can be slippery. Yeah. Great.
And that's it. The blue sky's gone. That's how quick it comes and goes. And it's low clouds again. Right down into the valley. Amazing. It was just magic. Path was slippery underfoot, so we just took our time. We actually had our joggers on to do this walk.
Safety double pluggers on today.
You left your pluggers at home.
Left me safety pluggers at home. Bit cold on the foot today.
So yeah, it was rock steps and a fair bit of leaf and grassy mossy foliage on it as well, so made it a bit slippery underfoot and it was steep.
Steep walking.
Yeah, so we just took our time, had no hassles, had no dramas. Yeah, you can see the fog there, or the cloud through the trees. It's incredible how it can change so badly, or so quickly. I mean, the weather's not bad, it's raining, but just the way it closes in so fast.
Different in the snow?
Yeah, it would be. Honeymoon 9 years ago, it was in October, and we came up to Thredbo thinking that in October it'd be quite warm, but the first place we headed to when we got out of the car was the ski shop to buy beanies and thick jackets because we absolutely froze. It was windy. It was that windy when we got there in October, and an ice chill wind. They closed all the chairlifts down and had ice caps on all the mountains, didn't they?
It did indeed.
So, there's a little waterfall there on the side of the road, if I got it. I don't know if I did. David's got all our lights back on again. You can hopefully see them when we get into the darker undergrowth. Or under the canopy of the forest.
Hit that subscribe button on all socials, Insta, Facebook, YouTube. Keep following for more content.
And we'll catch up with you. Bye. Obviously, just then. Incredible, eh?
Victorian high country. You never know what's going to be thrown at you. Up to you.
coming down off the mountain at the moment as well, so you can imagine what it'd be like higher up.